worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, was Cypress Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Friends, the seven links to awakening lead to enlightenment. A not very well known bhikkhu once asked Cypress Buddha, "Venerable sir, the seven links to awakening, the seven links to awakening, it is always said. In what way are they called links to awakening?" The Buddha then replied, "They lead to enlightenment, friend. It is therefore they indeed are called links to awakening. Here, bhikkhu, when one trains, cultivates, and refines the awareness link to awakening, sati sambhuyanga, the investigation link to awakening, dhammavichaya sambhuyanga, the energy link to awakening, Virya Sambhuyanga, the joy link to awakening, Piti Sambhuyanga, the tranquility link to awakening, Prasadi Sambhuyanga, the concentration link to awakening, Samadhi Sambhuyanga, the equanimity link to awakening, Upekka Sambhuyanga, based upon seclusion, disillusion and ceasing, maturing and culminating in release, then these seven links to awakening becomes noble and liberating. They lead anyone who trains them all out. They lead to utter revulsion, to intense disgust, to dispassion, to cessation of craving and greed, to peace, to direct knowledge, to complete destruction of suffering. They lead to enlightenment, to nibbana. What are the causes of knowledge and vision? A prince named Fearless once asked the Blessed Buddha, "Venerable sir, what are the conditioning causes of knowledge and vision?" The Buddha then answered, "Here, prince, the bhikkhu systematically develops 1. The awareness linked to awakening, 2. The investigation of states linked to awakening, 3. The energy linked to awakening, 4. The joy linked to awakening, 5. The tranquility linked to awakening, 6. The concentration linked to awakening, and 7. The equanimity linked to awakening. While based upon seclusion, disillusion, ceasing, and maturing in release, when his mind is enhanced and enforced by these seven links to awakening, then he knows and sees all phenomena just as they really are. This is indeed, therefore, a cause for knowledge and vision. It is in this very way that knowledge and vision are caused by these ultimately specific conditions." The prince then asked, "What is this Dhamma explanation called, Venerable sir?" "These unique mental states are called the links to awakening, prince." "Surely they are links to awakening, blessed one. Surely they are links to awakening, fortunate one. If anyone who possesses even a single link to awakening would know and see things as they really are, what then to say of one who possesses all these seven links to awakening?" How are the seven links leading to awakening? Venerable Sariputta once explained, "They conduce and lead to the state of enlightenment. In this sense are the links to awakening. They are in and of themselves enlightening. Also in this sense are they indeed links to awakening. Establishing as a meaning of awareness has to be directly experienced. examination as a meaning of investigation has to be directly experienced. Exertion of effort as a meaning of energy has to be directly experienced. Intense contentment as a meaning of joy has to be directly experienced. Stilled peace as a meaning of tranquility has to be directly experienced. Non-distraction as a meaning of concentration has to be directly experienced. Even balance as a meaning of equanimity has to be directly experienced. They are enlightening as a root. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as a cause. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as a requisite. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as a purification. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as blamelessness. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as withdrawal, exit. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as delivering freedom. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as lack of fermentation. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as silent, solitary, seclusion. Thus are they links to awakening. They are enlightening as a releasing, relinquishment. Thus are they links to awakening. The Connected Discourses of the Buddha, the Samyutta Nikaya, Book 646, on the links, and in the path of discrimination, the Patita Sambhita Magga. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 88, recorded on the 11th January 2018 under the Cypress tree along the Cypress Hermitage in the central hill country of Sri Lanka. Welcome. There are three questions. One Lotus report, one work report, but first the normal intro. Namo Tasso Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha, indeed. You take the lotus offering to the Lord Buddha's tooth inside candy at the Temple of the Tooth at Dalila Maligava first, and it is done from an offering from Mr. Alfred Quinn from New Zealand, and he would like to offer this to his deceased family. First of all, his mother and father, Alfred and Joan, his daughter Mary, and his nephews Christopher and Andrew. May they fare well in the future by this lotus offering that comes right here.
Yeah.
Thanks to Alfred for the offering and for the support over a long time from New Zealand, and may his family indeed enjoy the benefit and the probability from this offering to the Lord Buddha's tooth in Dalila Marikawa. Regarding work, we've done three things. We put down, there was a water pipe blowout from the hydropower installation I made 7 years ago, or 10 years ago actually. That blew out, and under high pressure, it's a 2-inch pipe, and this we have to repair. And this is one part of the work. Then I found out that I reused some iron bars from a former tea factory from colonial time. And so they were around 130 and 140 years old. And now they were rusted through. And regarding rust, it is worth noticing one of Buddha's saying that rust is like the evildoer, because rust eats its own base. When rust keeps rusting up from an iron bar, then the iron bar crumbles and disappears. It vanishes. It's destroyed. So also with the wrongdoer, the evildoer, he eats up his own base, his own existence, what keeps him up. So that's the simile of the rust. Last come a little bit about carrying up sand for the meditation hall, and this you will also see, and the work report comes right here.
Well, the lines of the hydropower plant here, you should see here, there's two lines, two-inch lines. Pipes of this size has broken, has bursted. That's on tour for 10 years. Now we're gonna find out which one.
Hydropower brake
line. Hydropower pipeline blowout. First day in meditation retreat. Anicca. Impermanence.
See, friends, here we had the hydropower blowout of the line. There's a 2-inch line down there. And there we put the had to put a new middle piece there. As you see, it's 2 inches roughly this size. Put it in here, set clamps, put it in there, set clamps. Because the pressure is very high. 8 bars, 9 bars. So it's something like 90 pound per square inches. It's double the pressure there is in cars. This runs down to the hydropower machine that is down there in the bush somewhere. And then it runs all the way up in two pipelines, all the way up the hill and towards up there. It took me a couple of years to dig out all this pipeline down here. There's one line coming over there and there's one line coming over there. There's meet down here. Two pipelines meeting down here in the middle and produce the electricity for the goody. And that's very satisfying that actually the power to send out and produce Dhamma is completely pure power. There's nothing fossil fuel, no pollution. It's mainly from hydropower, but then also from this guy up there, solar power, which burns fairly hot down here. See, friends, this is a small creek, the newest creek I added and cemented this path. And this runs down into this filter box. So stones cannot enter the filter. It's a horizontal filter that's down there. So it's cleaning itself. Otherwise it gets stuck all the time. But this actually makes this small water mix, because there's an air pressure of 80 meters free fall. Make something like 100 watts in that water. You see, there's the filter box. So the water runs in up there where the dirt is, and then it runs down in this mesh, stainless steel mesh. This filter box I made myself, it's version 3. Stainless steel and aluminium, doesn't go anywhere. Then there runs a 2-inch pipe under the ground here and into the jungle there and down the hill, approximately 130 meters down and 80 meters vertical. And this gives power together with two other intakes.
So, friends, as you see, the scaffolding of the last middle wall has come up, and iron is there, and a significant part of the sand has come. I think there's around 44 bags there. We need 44 more, then we can start bending the iron and putting it down in this form. And then afterwards, we can start to make the pillars. And when the pillars are finished, we can put on the roof. However, one small complication was that this roof over here actually stands on some pillars that were rotten. They were 130 years old. You see them on pictures here, very much damaged. So we had to make these cement repairs, and that complete will go up to here also. And here's the next box, because basically they were completely corroded down here in this area. Here in this area they were completely corroded. Here this is the best one of them, and that's even have a lot of material, but the other ones, they were collapsing. Then this root will fall down. So these boxes we had to make first. Little by little, the good one fills himself with good, or the bad one fills himself with bad, and little by little buildings are progressing, and little by little the path to Nirvana is one. Thank you.
So to the questions. The question 262. Will artificial intelligence evolution result in some sort of phenomenon like mind and matter? That is, artificial intelligence, AI, is a major, major, major deal. It's the AI who reads your letters. It's the AI that hears your voice and translates and answers you. So artificial neural networks, which I worked with extensively myself, you'll see a publication here. My major publication was on artificial neural networks, a computer method to recognize sites in proteins where they were put on sugars, certain O-link sugars. Where were they put on? And I know from this direct experience with working with artificial intelligence neural networks that they are much smarter than humans. Basically, they are, their intelligence and their abilities are not limited. They are only limited by the computer power and the memory power you can put into them. And this is not limited either, especially now with quantum computers in the horizon. There are many who are a little bit worried about this artificial intelligence, including myself. But to answer the question first, from a Buddhist point of view, can it emulate mind and matter? And the answer is clearly no. Why not? Because computers are not conscious. They are not conscious. A computer cannot be reborn. Same thing with this tree. It is a living system. As it can move, it can propagate, it can reproduce itself, and also other plants, but they are not conscious. So there are certain kinds of matter, rupa form, that consciousness can enfold in over. So there is a mind-made body that is superimposed on a material body that is our. And that requires, that explains near-death experiences and the remembrance of former lives that we have discussed before. And then the nice cardiologist just explained in the blog I made last week about near-death experiences, where the mind goes out from the dying body, looks down at the dying body, reports things, goes somewhere else and comes back to the dying body, and thereby is reunified with the same body. Transmigration will be that the mind-made body, the consciousness, goes and there reinforced in another body. But this cannot artificial intelligence do. If you pull the plug in, they pull the plug, they don't go anywhere else. The software can be replicated and put into another computer. It's in a situation that looks like rebirth. But it's not the same thing. Otherwise, I would say machines can do anything that humans can do, but much better. and much faster. Now chess robots can beat you, the best chess players, Go robots, all players can beat. And soon also this, they will also be able to play tennis and do all kinds of other things much better than we can do. Do they have free will? Yes, they can be. They can be programmed to simulate free will by putting in a random choice computer, random number generator, for example, a quantum number generator. So they make kind of like choices after certain probability distributions, but they're still not conscious. Can there in the future be? Can machines make machines themselves? Yes, they do that already. It's machines that makes computers basically. It's not humans, not much humans collection. Huh? Can they design new machines? Yes, they can. They can. Can there in the future be a machine against man war? Yes, I can. It's a very common theme in science fiction, and I think it is because it's a pre-recognition, premonition into the future of what may happen. So there's a reason to be worried. But man's, we will say, why are we using machines? It's because we think they can solve our problem of suffering. But machines cannot solve the problem of suffering. They cannot solve, because of impermanence. And in the case of machines against man, coming against man in one giant cataclysmic war, that's even more suffering. Whether it be 500, 1,000, or 200 years out in the future, is not to be known. But robots can be made very, very intelligent, much, much, much more intelligent, faster, better, more able to anything than humans. However, they are not conscious. Consciousness is something else. It's not emanating out of matter. It's not an emergent property of matter. Brain does not produce consciousness, and consciousness can be, it's superimposed, it's facilitating consciousness. It's like a transmitter or your mobile phone. It receives radio waves and transmits radio waves also, containing information, specific information, internet information, binary information, analog information, voice information. All kinds of information can be embedded in this wave phenomena called electromagnetic radiation. But the mobile phone, the radio, does not produce the information embedded in the radio waves. It transmits, emits, and transmits. So it's a receiver and a transmitter. Usually it's called a transmitter. It's that you can both emit and receive signals. So you transmit, and so also this is a transmitter, just like your computer, your mobile phone. That's a brain. The mind is another story, because mind is working enfolded on brain, using brain as a computer, just as you use a computer. But it contains something else that is called consciousness, vijnana, and this you cannot find in a computer. And you cannot make with a computer, and it cannot emerge in a computer, however big you make it. It cannot emerge in a petri dish full of live cells, even full of neuron cells. You cannot force consciousness to embed itself there unless it wants to. So is it. So yes and no. Artificial intelligence can be much better than humans, but they're not conscious. So they will never be like mind and matter. They have no mind. They have software programs, artificial neural networks, very fast, parallel computing, very able, very accurate, but not conscious. I hope this answers this question. Question 263. What is craving for non-becoming? First of all, what is craving in Buddhism is a central concept. Craving is either the push or the pull of the mind to something. Where does craving come in? Craving comes in as the cause of suffering. There's a second noble truth. This is suffering. Craving causes suffering. 3. Absence of craving equals no suffering. The way to achieve absence of craving is the noble eightfold way. It's the fourth noble truth. So the second word, craving, is the cause or the arising of suffering. Dukkha samudaya. The arising of suffering. And this is this pull or push. Pull towards pleasant objects and push away from painful objects. And neglect of neutral objects. So it's connected to the emotional, affective part of mind evaluating the phenomena. If mind evaluates the phenomena as painful or unpleasant, then it tries to come away. There's a push there, creating the suffering. If it mind has a pleasurable feeling or pleasurable remembrance, expect that the object is pleasant, then there's a pull towards the object, a craving towards the object, to have the object, possess the object, take in the object, take up the object. And this causes clinging. Clinging causes becoming, bhava. Becoming causes birth of the next moment of the next life. Birth causes aging, decay, sickness and death. So is the arising of this whole mass of suffering. So craving is the core opposite. It is right there the problem arises. When there's contact, contact cannot be denied as long as you are in the world. There will be contact with the world. As long as there's contact, feeling, vedana, will arise. Pleasant feeling, neutral feeling, painful feeling. But what can do is to cut the causal connection between feeling and craving. Cut, right there. Well, there's feeling, painful feeling, pleasant feeling, neutral feeling, but craving doesn't arise. Why not? Because there's awareness of the feeling arising and the feeling ceasing. Another feeling arising, another feeling ceasing. So mind says, so what? No need to buzz around, pulling or pushing in this or that, just because there's feeling. Huh? Cut. This cuts this cycle of paticca samuppada, of dependent co-arising. And that's the way to enlightenment, actually. Craving for non-becoming. So there you see three kinds of craving. Craving for sense pleasure, first of all, most dominant force in the entire universe and among all beings, is craving for sights, sounds, smells, tastes, touches, and mental states. Craving for sensuality, kama chanda, kama tanna, tanna, thirst for, is a little translation of the word tanna, usually translated as craving, and well so. Then there's this was first kind of craving. Second kind of craving, craving for becoming. What is craving for becoming? This is craving for becoming rich, craving for becoming young, beautiful, praised, famous, craving for any other state that one has now that one thinks was need. Craving for having this and that job in the future. Craving for having this and that partner, this and that car. Craving for one who owns this or have this or possess this characteristics. Craving for being very beautiful with big boobs for the ladies and with big muscles for the males. Or craving for being very famous and praised among the others. Craving for being divine. Craving for becoming enlightened. It's all this craving that is causing suffering. What is then this craving for non-becoming? Yeah, this is exact craving just for the opposite states. It's that has been early on translated as the craving for extinction. But that's a very special case of it that is very rare to see, actually. Because there are very few beings craves for extinction. Even those who commit suicides, they are craving for something else than this life, but they are not craving for extinction. So I think it's a mistranslation, actually. Vibhava-tanna. Bhava-tanna is craving for becoming. Craving for non-becoming is vibhava-tanna. And that is craving for not becoming old. not becoming ugly, not becoming poor, not becoming criticized, not becoming disrespected, not becoming insignificant in society, as the opposite of fame. So not becoming any of the bad of the worst, not having pain, not becoming sick, not becoming depressed, not becoming old, and basically not becoming dead. This is vibhava tanha, not becoming, craving for bad future states to flood in on one. However, it's easy to see how it gives rise to suffering, because you cannot escape aging, sickness, and death. So these states that are craving for not becoming old, not becoming gray with wrinkles and teeth falling out, or becoming gray, or having bad sight and bad hearing, and lack of abilities to remember and to speak, to recognize things and to learn new things. This is inevitable, inevitable in samsara, because of impermanence. When there has been birth, jati, there will be this aging, sickness and death, marana. There will be. Everybody knows that, so this craving for non-becoming starts right at birth. People fear death as soon as they know that they're dying. When everybody have an accident or cut in the finger, the first splint in the finger, or the first time you're getting scolded by your mother, then there's this fear that this will happen again, that this will become again. These undesirable states, which are numerous, which happens every day, every second. Not becoming dissatisfied, not becoming confused, not becoming frustrated, not becoming in a state of doubt and uncertainty, not becoming impatient. All this craving is craving for not becoming, vibhava tanha, which happens all the time, all the time. It's basically two things of the same coin. If you crave to be rich, then there is a craving, and craving for not becoming poor. If you crave to be young, then there's a, at the same time, in parallel, a craving not to become old. If there's a craving to become beautiful, then there's a craving not to become ugly. If there's a craving to become praised, then there's a craving to not become criticized. If there's a craving to become famous, then there's a, at the same time arising a craving not to become insignificant or disrespected. So it's two sides of the same coin that arise and cease simultaneously, at the same time. What the mind craves towards, it craves against the opposite state. Rich. If it craves towards be rich, it fears, craves away from becoming poor. So that is vibhava tanha. I hope this explains the question. I will give a link below about craving and the three kinds of craving. Again, craving for sensuality, craving for sensing, seeing, hearing, tasting, touching, and having mental state. Craving for becoming, all pleasant states, rich, famous, beautiful, young, healthy, praised, famous, and craving vibhava tanha, for not becoming old, insignificant, poor, sick, dead, criticized, and things like that. Two sides of the same coin. Two sides of the same coin. If there's craving for becoming this state, then there's craving for not becoming the opposite state. Always so. Always so. And again, craving is the cause of suffering, the second noble truth. And the way to end craving is this noble eightfold way. Question 264. What passes on at the death moment from the dying person to the next rebirth? We have discussed this before. Is it form? No. The form dies. Is it brain? No. Is it feeling? No. Is it perception? No. Is it mental constructions? No. Is it consciousness? Is there a soul that somehow? No. Consciousness arises and ceases. There's only one moment of it. It happens also now. You have one moment of visual consciousness that sees this thing that your mind then interprets being a monk, talking, you're hearing the sound, you're putting together the phonemes. So there was first a moment of visual consciousness. This sees right there. Then there's a moment of auditory consciousness. They report to mental consciousness that then interprets the visual data as monk and the auditory data as words. But you cannot see and hear and think at the same time. So it's blinking states. Blinking states of either visual consciousness, auditory consciousness, tactile consciousness, or mental consciousness, interpreting mental data. This also goes, so when this moment goes down, why does the next one arise? It is because there is craving for becoming conscious, basically, and has been there for a long time. So this, when there has this probability accumulation of a new conscious moment to arise has been there, then there will arise there, and this has been there for a long time. This means there is an accumulation, a stacking up of probabilities for the next moment to arise. And this means that any moment here, now, we desire to be conscious, this will create future conscious moments. And this you cannot create in a petri dish full of live neural cells. This you cannot, this craving for becoming, you cannot artificially create on a chip or on a solid state drive. You cannot. You cannot. It's a chain that has been, of craving that has gone on since time immemorial. It cannot be discerned whenever it started. It started because of ignorance of the Four Noble Truths. How do you want to embed ignorance of the Four Noble Truths, not to say knowledge of the Four Noble Truths, in a petri dish, on a hard state drive, or in a microchip? They're basically not conscious. So what passes on at death moment? Actually, it is conditionality or causality. It's a very interesting question. If we have one moment here and one moment here, what's in between? There's nothing, actually. Same thing with the quantum jump. The electron ceases to be here in this orbit, and then it's found in this orbit, but it never go into the two orbits. So it's not like the electron passes from here to there. It ceases to be here and re-arises there instantaneously. And this is a quantum jump. And you can say in discrete time, whether it's material time or mental time, it's the same. There's some forces here, conditionality, some pushes that springs over into this moment, but in a indiscrete way. It's not like a continuum. When this moment goes down, if there's craving in this moment to be conscious, when this goes down, then this next moment arises. And when this moment of consciousness ceases, if there's craving in this, inherent in this mind and matter continuum to be consciousness, then the next moment arrives. So what is passed on, Patisandhi, in the Patisandhi moment, the rebirth, the transmigration moment, where this being dies and this being rearises immediately after, is the same as happening now, where you're reborn, probably in the order of 100,000 billion, 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 billion times per second. It is conditionality or causality or causal drives, causal factors that will have effects, like seeds. If there's a seed planted here, then there will be a sprout here. If there's been a cause planted here, then there will be an effect there. because of this causality, is jumping over. Actually, you can say it's nice to understand from a statistical point of view, namely probability. Probability is some. What is probability? Yeah, it is a likelihood for something to happen in the future. And the same thing with the rebirth moment, when the last consciousness goes down, if it has a craving for this and that, has a karmic accumulation for this and that, then the consciousness, next moment consciousness, will find the path of less resistance through this non-local, non-temporal milieu of cause and effect, and then unfold there where there's less resistance. Basically, we say, if the mind here is very ignorant, then animal rebirth in the next moment is to be expected. If it's very greedy, then a hungry ghost is to be expected. If it's very angry, then angry demon or hell being is to be expected. If it's very wise and content and calm, then divine rebirth is to be expected. If it has accumulated the cause by generosity and practice of the Noble Eightfold Way, that is to say, it's a pure mind. What do I mean by pure mind? It is a mind where greed, hate and ignorance and all the concomitant secondary factors such as jealousy, anger, irritation, opposition, stubbornness, rigidity, they have been diminished, either reduced or completely eliminated. So when there's this non-ignorant, non-greedy, non-hating mind, which has reduced the five mental hindrances significantly, then these bad rebirths are not to be expected in the next, very next moment here. Then either human, at whatever the many levels of human rebirths, in the many states, rich as poor, high as low, ugly as beautiful, are to be expected here. Or higher than human are to be expected. So in discrete states, is discrete jumps from one conscious moment to the next conscious moment. But since there are so many of these conscious moments, as I said, the frame rate on your computer is 30 frames per second. You are seeing this video now with 30 frames per second. I could also encode it in 60 frames per second. But basically it will blink whatever your computer screen is set up to blink with, and it's usually 30 frames per second. If you go into the cinema, then you see and see an analog film that is projected in front of a lamp, then it's 24 still frames per second. If you look at the single frame, nothing is happening. It's just a photograph. Same thing with your mind. It's processing still visual images now, one after the other. One like hand is here. Next the hand is here, next the hand is here, next the hand here, next the hand here, next the hand here, next hand here, next hand here. So it looks like it's a continual movement of the hand through space and time. But actually it's just a series of discrete blinks that is very, very, very fast. And that creates the illusion of continuity. The illusion of continuity, where actually it is contiguity, discrete moments like pearls on a string, where each moment, each state, each atom of existence, each Dhamma in Buddhism, each Planck moment in physics, is a discrete still state where nothing happens, that has specific characteristics, that says something about the time evolution of the next moment, the next state. So there's some seeds here, some conditional factors here, some causes there that will have effects here. But they are not propagated in a continuous way. They are discrete moments. When this one ceases, the next one arrives. So, again, what passes on at the death moment from the dying person to the next rebirth? Causality, conditionality. Karma, the accumulation of probability, passes on. Both at the Patisandhi rebirth transmigration moment, and now also. I'll give a link to this because it's a tricky issue. I'll give you a link below here to what passes on by rebirth linking. We've touched on it before, we'll probably touch on it again. But again, it's conditionality, it's probability, it's a karmic accumulation for very specific things, probability, likelihood for something to happen in the future that is passed on. It's not a soul. There was no soul in the first place. It's not an ego, it's not a self, it's not a substance. Because there was no ego, substance or self in the first place, how can it transmigrate to another place? There's nothing in there except conditionality, impersonal states. Thank you for your attention, clever consideration, and kind contribution. Thank you to those who have given food here the last two times. Indeed, thank you very much. And indeed, also thank you very much to those who give a little bit every month and make the wheels running here on the Hermitage so I can make repairs and go to the dentist. I got a tooth extraction recently. And thank you also to those who support the meditation hall. One keyword that Pinfan Lamel made me understand from these purple people who have near-death experiences was that they meet beings that they intuitively and instantly understood was embedding two things at the same time. One, unconditional love. And two, profound wisdom. This unconditional love, joined with, fused with this profound wisdom, I think is worth hanging on to and going around clinging, looking as a goal towards. How can I, or this continuum of naming and forming, this mind and matter sequence or process, how can this be made to flow towards both unconditional love towards all beings whatsoever, in the same time joined with profound wisdom of the nature and causality of all existence? How can that come? The answer is apparent and clear, the Noble Eightfold Way. Thank you. Given to us by all the Buddhas, the last one, Siddhartha Gautama, and also the next one, Ajitamitaya. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha, indeed. You can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparella, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Thank you
for your contribution. And hell and ice.